Hi guys, Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. It's Monday night, you know what that means. We are streaming, we are talking about guitar. It is the highlight of my week. I'm really glad you guys could join me. As you can see by the fetching blue backdrop behind me, we are at Guitar Interactive HQ. I'm shooting a brand new course for you guys. We'll talk more about that a little bit later on, but before we do anything, let's just quickly drop into the stream, see how you guys, our friends, new and old, are getting on. Let's just see what's going on. So we have some questions coming in already. If you have questions, drop them in the comments. You know what to do. We'll get to that in a moment. But let's just check in, see how our friends are getting on. What do we have? So David Yates is in. We're not going to make that joke, David. We've done it a bunch of times. Actually, David, got something for you here real quick. We talk about this all the time. I read David Yates's name is Dorian Yates because I'm a meathead. Dear David, I was given this at a gig just this weekend from my friend Liam. This, and if you guys can see, is a plectrum with a picture of Arnold Schwarzenegger on it, which makes me very happy. Some more on that later. David Yates. Justin Ray is in. We got something for you, Justin, in just a moment. Who else do we have? Marcin is tuning in. Marcin, it's great to see you. Absolute pleasure having you on board. Who else is on? Roy Lisbon is in. Bend vibrato today. Roy, you are correct. We're doing bending and vibrato. My laptop's over here, by the way, in case you guys are wondering why I'm snaring in this direction. Kim's tuning in, so I best be on my best behavior. Kim is from his summer residence somewhere a lot warmer than I am right now. I'm not jealous in the slightest, Kim. Very, very jealous. Cowcat says, bend till I die. 100% best technique you can do on the guitar is bending. That is my opinion. Steve McDee, hi all, looking forward to this one as I am working on exactly this topic. Steve, I'm really happy you could join us in that case because hopefully we're going to have some insights for you. Felicia is tuning in. Felicia, it's great to have you back on board. Lovely to see you. Blue Sumlin, a regular. I think Blue Sumlin has been on every stream we've done so far, so it's great to see you. Finn Muso says, hi everyone. Mark McNish says, hello everyone. Sacred Godslayer says, hi guys. Our community is in full force. It's great to see you. Who else do we have? Andreas Walter Guitar says, hi guys. Andreas, I believe you're a first time commenter. If you're not, I do apologize. It is lovely to have you. Larry H says, g'day. Timothy Appalling, is still appalling from the Florida Keys. It is a great punk name. Apparently the audio sounded pretty good, so I'm happy about that. We've had a couple of issues in the last couple of streams, but I'm glad it's working for you guys. Great to have you on board. Joe Johnson's tuning in. Double denim, the Canadian tuxedo. What a power move. But they're different colors of denim, or at least different shades of gray, if nothing else. What else do we have? Ocean Tracks says, vibrato is the hardest thing for me and I've been playing forever. Hopefully we're going to crack this one for you tonight. PT is tuning in, not from around the corner from me today because I'm at the other end of the country, but from around the corner from my house, which is cool. Highly Strung 1000 is tuning in from Portsmouth. Great to have you on board. Neil, it's great to have you on board. A pleasure. So listen, we have so many great guitar players coming in and so many comments. I would love to address them all. We'll get to them all in the Q&A. Let me just do a bit of housekeeping before we get any further. So if you guys are enjoying these streams and you'd like to support us, best way you can do it, there's a couple of ways. You can drop us a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching on. You can drop us a comment because the algorithm loves comments. So you can share this with your guitar playing friends. And also the absolute best way that you can support us is by checking out GI Plus. Logos up here. GI Plus is the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive magazine. The latest course we've dropped is Technique Hotfixes. It's one of mine, but I have just seen the roughs from our new slide course this week, our new slide for standard tuning course. A friend of mine, Ian Simo, has done that. You want to see this course. It's going to blow some minds. It certainly blew mine. I have the first of my modes courses in the can. That's coming for you guys very soon. All of this stuff is included in your guitar intro, your GI Plus membership. Of course, if you want to get hold of Technique Hotfixes, that is available in the GI Plus store too. So anyway, before we get on to today's topic of bending and vibrato, I asked you guys last week if you were up for jamming with me, and you guys delivered in such a big fashion. So what we have is we have no less than three passes over our 12 bar blues. We're going to take a look at them today, and then I'm going to give you guys some tips. I'm going to ask you guys in the comments if there's anything you can think of that you really, really like in these passes, or anything, any advice you can offer our guitar players. I'd love to hear from you guys too. Also, Once we've done that, we're going to stitch this together. I'm going to play some stuff in the gaps, and we're going to put a jam on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel, so you guys who participate in our jam, you will be able to see yourself on our YouTube channel for the whole world. It is really, really cool. So let's get stuck in with that, and then we'll get into today's topic, which is going to be bending and vibrato, namely, how do you combine the two? So let's get on this. First of all, let's take a look at some of our blues jams. Now, last week, I asked you guys if you were up for playing along with a blues with me. We played along with this guy. This is our Chicago blues in A with horns. It's this blues track. I'm going to take a pass just to show you guys what's going down. Let me turn the delay off. Let me just switch to a different amp model with a huge, huge, huge amount of hiss for just a moment, but that's fine. It's going to sound something like this. Our blues from last week. We've had some really, really killer entries, so we'll be doing another jam this week. If you guys are interested in jamming with me, let me know in the comments. I would love to know if you want to play along. Let's take a look at some of the entries we've had. So we're going to begin with Justin. Justin sent his entry in over Instagram. I think it's really, really killer. There are some very cool ideas going on. Justin was also kind enough to leave me some space to jam along with him, which is very cool. So if you go and find Justin's video, I will post links to that in the comments after this stream, so you can all go and subscribe to Justin. So that'll be in the comments section in this video after this stream. But this is Justin. Let's take a listen. I am going to offer Justin some advice. I would like you guys to let me know what you think about Justin's playing too. Let's keep it on the positive, but there's nothing to be negative about. Justin plays great, so let me know what you guys think Justin is doing well, what you think he could do better. I will do the same. Let's take a listen. So that's Justin's pass. I think it sounds killer. Let me know in the comments what you guys think. We're going to go to the comments section so we can see what's happening. Let me know what you guys have for Justin in terms of criticism, in terms of advice. First of all, what I want to say, Justin, is that's a fine guitar you have there. Great choice. We do like a PRS here on the stream. I feel like one of the best things about that pass was just how melodic it was. I feel like you were really quite restrained. I feel like you maybe resisted the urge to just kind of blow chops over the top of it, which is killer, something I struggle with. I really do kind of, you know, I tend to get lost in my own chops a little bit. You resisted that urge very, very well. The tone was great from what I could tell. It looked like a camera microphone. It looked like you'd had mic to cab up, but you know, when you've done enough of this stuff, like myself, you can kind of hear through these things. I think the tone was very, very good. A couple of little critiques. So first of all, what I noticed, let's just go quickly to the close-up camera, was on these bends, these, there was a couple of little pitch errors. And now, I don't think this is necessarily your fault. It's not that you can't, you know, you can't identify that stuff, but I noticed a technical error that might be leading to a couple of those pitch errors and also might be inhibiting your ability to apply a nice vibrato on those notes. Now, what I noticed was that the fingers on your right hand, or your left hand even, seem to be quite firm, seem to be quite stiff. Now, I personally encourage a loose finger feel when it comes to bends. So I like to keep the fingers loose when I'm bending. I like to make all of the movement come from the big strong muscles in my forearm and my upper arm. This allows me to have fingers that are loose enough to adjust the pitch so it intonates just kind of just right, just where I want it. And this also means that we're not so tight that we can't apply a little bit of vibrato. Now, there was another thing you did that I wanted to kind of flag up. It was just when we got to this note. I really liked the way you found your way to this D over those chord tones. I thought that was great. Really highlighted the changes really, really nicely. I love the way you found your way there. But when we got there, the vibrato was very good, but then it kind of sort of stopped. You kind of went. Which to me, I like to hear, once you've put a vibrato on a note, I like to hear it go all the way to the end. So if you feel like you've done enough, don't be afraid just to stop that note. Don't be afraid just to let that stop. All in all, Justin, that was a really great pass. The tone was very good. I love the note flying off at the feedback. Just at the end, that was really cool. Some great choices, highlighted the chord changes really, really well. Very well into that. So let's see what else we have going on here. So we got a couple of things. Bluesbeard says, kind of cool, Justin. We actually have, the Blues Bastard. God, am I going to get demonetized? I don't really care. That's fine. We have Tom, the Blues Bastard submission in a moment, which is killer, by the way, might I add. Maybe a little more vibrato, says Tom. Blue Somlin says, cool, Justin, just letting the music breathe. A bit of silence can mean so much. Hey, you know, we could all learn from that, myself included. What else do we have? Justine, nice spacing between notes, didn't overplay, and good use of sustain. I will absolutely concur with this. Evan Ward says, establish the pitch before applying vibrato, especially on root notes. Very good advice, sage advice there. Nice spacing, says Sacred Godslayer. I'm very bad at that. Hey, identifying that it's something you struggle with is part of fixing the problem. So let's move on. We have two more submissions. We're gonna get through these and then we'll get into our question of the day. We're gonna take a look at Marcine. Now, Marcine has been on the stream before. We did a little bit of a look at Marcine's playing. Marcine's a fine guitar player. He played along with our cinematic backing track when we had a solo that I asked you guys to express in your own way. Took some inspiration for that for our new course, by the way. I'll tell you more about that another time. So this is Marcine. Again, let me know in the comments if you guys have any comments for Marcine, anything that you think went really well, any stuff that you would change. I will say, first of all, I've watched this and I'm really into the sound of this Strat, my man. So anyway, this is Marcine. Let's take a listen. Very cool little flourish with the bar at the end, my man. Really into that. So there are some very adventurous choices going on there that I'm really into. Some great use of diminished ideas, really leaning on that flat five, which is super cool. It's really interesting how outside that flat five sounded when you play this line right here, this. Now, a brief criticism on that. Now, when we played that flat five line, going to the four chord, I didn't feel like it really worked terribly well when he held on that flat five. I would have played the same line, maybe this. And then over the four chord, I would have maybe landed on that natural four, or you could have landed perhaps on the five. Bend it up to the natural six, that would work really well. I feel like that flat five was maybe a little sour for that, but it was, I mean, the setup was really, really cool. It was really just kind of the landing that I was, you know, I'd maybe change that a little bit. Again, though, really adventurous choices, little diminished ideas down here from our half whole scale, which is something we've talked about in the past. When you found yourself up at this end of the neck, things started getting really interesting. There were some very cool three and one ideas from what I could hear, which was great. A little criticism on that is the rhythmic idea where we went da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I would have been tempted to vary that a little bit the second time, but largely really, really cool. There was also this little thing at the start where I think we had, it was either a flat five or it was a like a seven to a six thing. Really bold way to start the solo. So some really cool melodic choices going on there. I feel like perhaps didn't quite stick the landing going to the four chord, but largely that was very, very cool. Great, great, great submission. Really adventurous stuff. Kind of getting out with the the trad blues thing, which I'm really kind of interested. So let's see what we've got going on in the comments real quick. Let's see, Sacred Godslayer says very cool note choices. Joe Johnson says love the outside notes. Nice Dissonance says bad Bilious Bob's Daily Dose. Man, these usernames are getting better, I swear. So we have one more submission. This is the appropriately named blues insert swear name here. This is Tom. Let's just say this is Tom. So again, we want some comments for Tom. If you guys have any comments, any advice, any criticisms, things you like, things you don't like, let's drop it in the comments for Tom. So first thing I'm going to say regarding Tom is Tom has an absolutely monster tone, just like the best sound, and I can see where it's coming from. He's got a lovely setup with his Morgan amp, I think it is, and an aux, you'll see what I'm talking about, and a really nice camera setup too, man. So the whole thing looks and sounds the absolute bee's knees. This is Tom, let's take a listen. So just dripping with confidence and vibe there, man. That is a killer, killer solo. Really economical, very, very in the pocket with the timing, but some nice choices highlighting those chords with this descending sixes thing. This, I don't think that's exactly what it was. It might be whatever that was. Really into that. That's absolutely fantastic. Something that I really, really, really enjoyed was just this choice to play these slides kind of in these kind of, you know, like in the middle of a phrase, like I'm not even gonna play a note, man. I'm just gonna play this big slide. So we'd have this. Sounds so, so cool, really, really full of attitude, very much into that. I don't have a lot to criticize about this, to be honest. The tone is great, the playing is great, the pocket is really tidy. A lot of it was kind of sitting in that minor pentatonic kind of space. I don't think that's a problem. I don't think it's a bad thing. Especially when we got to the five and the four chords, started to outline the changes a lot more, really into that. I feel like if you'd been given another pass or two, we would have seen some blending in of major and minor pentatonics, some more highlighting of the chord tones as they change. I can just tell that this guy knows what he's doing, right? That was a really great pass. And we have floods of comments for Tom. So let's see what's going on here. Here we go. I love this from David. Yes, Tom is mustard. Very committed playing, giving it his all, which I always think is great. Absolutely. PT says, and Tom, nice telly too. I feel like we've missed a comment at the top. Here we go. Most impressive thing is that Justin Demarcin had the bottle to send in a video in the first place. Absolutely. Listen, I wholeheartedly agree about this. We got some other cool vibes coming from Marcin's great note choices. Marcin says, thanks, guys. And what a tone, pure blues spirit in reference to Tom. Oh, yeah. Killer indeed. Tom, let's see, what are you doing here? You don't have stuff to learn. Good job. Man, 100% concur with that. Tom has absolutely nailed it. Tom says, thanks for the nice words, Nick. Tom, I'm not just blowing smoke, man. That was a really, really great pass. Very, very into it. So listen, we're going to link all these videos in the comments after this stream. You guys can go and check these guys out. Follow them on social media. We'll be putting a little compilation together of these passes. I'll take some passes in between. It's going to be great fun. We got loads of other cool stuff. Justin is saying, Tom sounded great. Great solo, man, and killer facial expression. The facial expression is where the tone lives. So listen, let's do this again. Let's do this again next week. I'm going to throw another track your guys' way. This time, we're going to take a look at this track. This is our C sharp minor, groove rock in C sharp minor. We will link this in the comments to this video, so come back and check it out. It is going to be this one right here. If I can find the thing, here it is. Now, I've been playing over this one all day. I think this is one of my favorite GI Plus tracks. So, It's going to be available. If you want to have a pass at this, let me know in the comments. Let me know, drop me a comment. Let me know that you're going to take a crack at this track. I'm going to play a little bit and then we'll get into the meat of today's stream. Here we go. That's going to be our track for this week's jam. Let me know in the comments if you guys want to take a crack at it. I would love to play along with you on this track. We'll be linking it below. That is available for you on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. While you're there, give us a like, give us a subscribe. You know what to do. So anyway, let's get into the meat of today's lesson, which is bending and vibrato and combining the two. Now, we've had some comments already from you guys. If you are struggling with this, or if you have any insights on this you'd love to share with our community, let me know in the comments. I'd love to hear from you. So let's talk about what we're dealing with here first of all. So bending and vibrato essentially is the act of taking a bend like this one and then adding some vibrato to the top of our bend like this. Let me just knock that delay off for a second. That might get a little bit irritating as we go forward. So once again. Now, it seems somewhat glib of me to say that's all it is, because people genuinely do struggle with this. And it's not just you guys out there who are kind of finding your way with the guitar. Even the pros struggle with this. Now, the most notable example is Robin Ford, who I've used as an example of this a bunch of times, who's famously said in interviews that he just doesn't do this. He doesn't do vibrato on top of bends. It's not his bag. So if you are struggling with this, A, you're not alone, and B, you can, in theory at least, become Robin Ford without ever cracking this particular technique. So hey, not necessarily a bad thing. If you feel like you're a less complete guitarist but not being able to do this thing, you are not. But we are going to make you a more complete guitarist by showing you how to do it. So let's talk about what it's not, first of all. So what this technique is not, in my estimation at least, is taking a bend and then pushing that bend further to make the vibrato. I don't think that's what's going on here. So if we take a look at conventional vibrato, let's go to the close-up camera again one more time. Close-up camera, if we go here onto the 12th fret, this is a B note on our B string, our conventional rock vibrato is taking this note, pushing it towards the ceiling or pulling it towards the floor, like so. Whichever works best for you. So pushing it towards the ceiling, pulling it towards the floor. There are rules of thumb for this. I tend to advocate for pushing on these strings, pulling on these strings, that's the wound strings, and the G string, you can do whichever feels more comfortable on a particular lick. Some people say push on these three, pull on these three. I feel like the G string is fairly flexible. We can push, we can pull. It's kind of neatly positioned that we're not going to come into trouble if we use the wrong style of vibrato, i.e. pushing versus pulling. So yeah, generally what we're doing is we're either pushing or pulling, and we are raising the pitch of the string, because that's our only option. The only thing we can do with a bending type vibrato on a note that isn't already being bended or bent is push it sharp. and then we release it, and that's where our vibrato comes from. Now, in our previous stream, we talked about the idea of vibrato having various parameters, having speed, having width, having arc, having onset, and having pressure parameters that we can play with. Just to quickly recap on those, speed is fairly obvious. Speed is how fast or how slow the pulses are. So if we have a slow vibrato, we might get this, which would be something more like our John Sykes vibrato. A fast vibrato with the same width would be this. And somewhere in between would be, say, a medium. And we discussed how players like Michael Schenker, John Sykes, Eric Johnson, how these guys all used various vibrati. We also got a copyright strike from Angus Young, but that's neither here nor there. Angus, if you're watching, I still love you. So anyway, that's our width, our speed rather. Width is simply how far we're displacing the string, being wide, being narrow. Arc refers to how linear or how square our vibrato pulses are. So a linear vibrato, which is very smooth from pitch to pitch, might sound like this. That was slow, so we can hear that arc. A more squared off vibrato might sound like this, which is more common than you might think. And our instincts would say linear is the way, but man, the squared off thing, more common than you think. Onset is how quickly we apply the vibrato when we land on the note. So this is something we had a comment about earlier. Let's just quickly find our way up to the top. Now, where was this? This was a really, really insightful comment from, let's see, it was in response to Marcin's playing. I've lost it. I apologize. I've lost it. But it was a very cool comment regarding establishing a pitch before. Ah, here we are. Here we go. It was from Evan Ward. Evan, I can't find your comment, but it was from Evan saying to establish the pitch. Here it is. Establish the pitch before applying vibrato, especially on root notes. This refers to our onset parameter that I like to think about it as. So if you have a vibrato with a fairly immediate onset, you might get something like this. In fact, that was a little delayed. Let's make that onset quicker. For a slightly longer onset, we might get this. And anything in between. We can also ease into the vibrato with our onset. That's another way to play about it. Pressure is something different. We won't get into that today. So there are vibrato parameters. We have width, speed, arc, onset. Pressure is something different. We'll get to that. Now, all of these apply to vibrato on top of bends. These are all things that still apply. The only difference is vibrato on top of bends, we don't just have to go up. We can go either side of the pitch. Now, this is something we get when we do classical vibrato, which is something we discussed in the Q&A last week, which is where we play this sort of thing. Much harder on the first finger, by the way. So that sort of idea, where we are able to go lower and higher than our starting pitch, this is something that other instruments that do vibrato are able to do. So singers do this, violins, cellos do this, classical guitar players do this. Who else? Woodwinds, any kind of wind instrument like sax, brass instruments. Basically everyone but us, we do this. But fear not, for we're able to do this when we do our vibrato stacked on top of a bend. This is why Brian May sounds so super, super vocal. He is the master at this sort of stuff. So let's work out what's going on there. What's not going on, as we said previously, is bending the pitch up and then just bending further. So let's get a close-up on that hand real quick. Excuse the clangs. Close-up on that hand real quick. So I'm up here. We are not just adding more bend at the top. That's not what's going on. What is going on is we're establishing a baseline pitch and we're fluctuating either side of this. So what we get instead is this. Now, the way I like to think about it, is actually just by dipping below the pitch. Now, what ends up happening is you go either side, but I like to think about dipping below the pitch. So it's almost like we do our bend, and then we do a partial release. So here's an exercise that you can do to get good at this stuff. If we take a bend, let's say a bend of a tone, see if you can release that by a semitone. Grab your guitars now and let me know. So we're gonna bend up, you're gonna release by a semitone. So we're not releasing the bend all the way, we're just releasing it some of the way and then letting it come back up to its original pitch. So we might get this. That is the feel of vibrato on top of bends. Now, if we start to speed it up, things start to turn into vibrato, where we'd get this. But there are some technical changes that need to be made to facilitate this. So one thing that I like to encourage for vibrato on top of bends is a loose finger. What I mean by this is a loose fretting finger. That basically means a fretting finger without much tension held within it. Now, you need a certain amount of tension to actually execute the bend. But here's a little trick from when we talked about string bends a couple of streams ago. Now, we can take some cues from elite violinists and the way they intonate. Now, if you've ever tried to play violin, I have not, but if you've ever tried to play violin, intonating it is a nightmare, especially at the level of like elite symphony violinists and soloists and all this sort of stuff. The reason for this is it's not enough just to use muscle memory to like kind of not fret, but to put your finger in the right place to get the right pitch out. You would think that muscle memory alone would show our violinist or take our violinist to the right pitch. It doesn't. What happens is it puts the violinist in the ballpark, and then they have to roll their finger, either left or right, up and down, to massage the pitch into its proper intonation. Singers do this too. Singers sing in such a way that they're relaxed enough that they can reflexively correct the pitch. So too much tension as a singer, I know this is a vocal coach, too much tension as a singer can lead to pitch issues, not because tension inherently equals bad pitch, but because you're not flexible and relaxed enough to the point where you can adjust enough, like quickly enough, to get your intonation in. The same is true for violin. If you are too tense, you're not able to adjust on the fly. The same is also true for bends. If you're having trouble bending in tune, you might think about relaxing the fingers of your hand and then making most of the propulsion of the bend come from the big strong muscles in the upper arm and the forearm. Relatively speaking, you don't have to be strong to do this. It's not like a strength game, but the muscles in these parts of your arm are stronger than the muscles in this wavy bit at the end of your arm. Now, these fingers being loose will enable us to essentially react to the pitch we're bending to and massage it into tune. If you take a look at my fingers here, real quick, you will notice them slightly buckle, to the point where it looks like I'm using my fingers to propel the vibrato. I promise you I'm not. What's happening is as I'm bending, my fingers are just bowing slightly under the pressure of the string. They're not like completely buckling to the point where they just fall to bits, but there's just enough looseness in there that there's a little bit of give, just a tiny bit of give, like a spring, maybe, I guess, is a way of thinking about it. Now, the cool thing about this is this then enables you, because you're loose, or you're not gripping onto the fretboard with everything you got, it enables you to then slightly release some of the pressure, either with your fingers or with the big strong muscles in your arm, to create this vibrato by slightly releasing the pressure and then bringing it back to pitch, like so. Now that would be an example of a subtle version of this. If you were to release all the way to your pitch, you would get something more akin to a Malmsteen or a Zach Wilde type vibrato, where you would get, which is like literally going all the way down, but fast. But it still requires a loose left-hand touch. That's not to say that we have to be gentle with the guitar and we can't wrestle the thing, but the wrestling doesn't come from the hand, it comes from the arm and occasionally the shoulder. Now let's talk a little bit about the role of the thumb in this, because the thumb is also a very misunderstood thing. Now your thumb, if it's too tight, is going by definition to introduce tension into your playing. Now, I want to do a quick experiment here. Just grab a guitar real quick. I want you to find a position on the fretboard and just waggle your fingers around. Just go 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever order you like, right? Now, while you're doing this, just press your thumb as hard as you can to the back of the neck and see what happens. Nope, all these fingers tighten up. No good, no bueno. Now, we have been told as guitar players for the longest time, that it's necessary for us when we're bending and applying vibrato, it's necessary for us to have a thumb over the top and for the thumb to squeeze the neck as we go. I don't think this is true, and I'll tell you what I think is actually going on in a moment. And also, when we're doing pull bends and pull vibrato, it's necessary for us to have this fulcrum where we have this part of our finger against the neck of the guitar, and that is squeezing and releasing this squeeze. I actually don't think that's happening. And we looked at some videos in our previous stream that would hint at this not being the case, specifically for people like Peter Green, who lifts his thumb off the back of the neck. You won't be able to see that, I don't think. I think we had to cut that out on the replay. So yeah, you gotta be there, I guess. But also we looked at Andy Timmons in the stream previous to that with this lifting of the thumb on his bends and on his vibrato. What I think is happening here, when you have your thumb on top of the neck, I don't think it's so much squeezing the neck of the guitar. I think what it's doing is it's stabilizing the neck of the guitar, but you don't have to do that with your thumb. Here's the deal, right? So let's go up to the close-up camera. If I were to push very, very hard with my fingers, let's say I pushed up here, eventually there's gonna come a point where the guitar moves and the force that I'm putting into the string is dissipated by the simple fact that the guitar is lifting off my lap. Likewise, if I pull too hard, there's gonna come a point where this guitar is just gonna kind of go like this and it'll fall off my knee. Now, if I do the same, but I keep my thumb off the neck, so put it here so you guys can see, but I use my, look at the small camera, up in the top top left as you look at it. If I use my arm up here to brace the guitar against my body, watch what happens. I can pull, I can push, the guitar is not moving, and it enables me to transfer all of the force of my upper arm into the neck of the guitar. Thumb is not involved. I think what's happening here with your thumb is just stabilizing the neck of the guitar. It's just holding it in place so that you can actually execute these bends. So I think, yes, you can use your thumb looped over the top to create bends. You don't have to. You can use this part of your arm to stabilize the guitar. You can use some combination of your strap, your body, maybe your leg, whatever, to stabilize the guitar's neck. And you can still get some convincing bends and vibrato like so. With the thumb all the way off. Now, apologies about tuning. This is not normally how I do this stuff, but even with the thumb way down here or even hanging off the back of the neck, we can still execute these techniques. The thumb is not necessary. This doesn't mean, don't get this twisted, it doesn't mean that you're wrong if you have your thumb over the top. That is a perfectly valid way to execute this stuff. But you don't need the thumb looped over the top to execute this. All you need is a way of stabilizing the guitar so you can transmit the force from your upper arm into the string with a loose set of left-hand fingers. If you do this, you will have more success with this stuff than you may have had in the past. I will personally guarantee this. So we have a whole bunch of great comments that I want to get into. I want to know what you guys want to know. So if you have questions for me, we're going to do this in about 5 minutes time. Drop your questions in the comments. I would love to know what questions you have regarding this stuff, and we'll get into this in greater detail. We have some of them already. I'm going to delve more deeply into that, but let's get a little bit further in how you might practice this bends and vibrato thing. So one of my favorite ways to do this is to use pre-bends. So if you don't know what I mean by pre-bends, we're just getting the backing track ready for you guys. Pre-bends, let's do the, Ooh, let's pick one. Let's do the Top Gun ballad. I do like this one. I might throw my delay back on for this. Pre-bends is where you would essentially bend a note ahead of time before you've actually picked the note and hold it in position. Now, if you do your pre-bend, we can do our pre-bend with a release-type vibrato to get this kind of sound. Which is very much the Brian May vibrato. If you listen to Brian, all over his stuff, and it sounds just absolutely tremendous. I would encourage you to maybe try soloing using pre-bends. Now, you don't actually need to pre-bend from a particular scale note. If I was playing, for example, something in E minor pentatonic, which might be like this, I could simply pre-bend from a semitone down from whatever it is I'm trying to play. So if I play it here, I could play, instead of here, pre-bend there. So let's say, for example, you know what it is? I'm going to change this stuff, right? I'm going to change this stuff real quick. I'm going to go to the Led Zeppelin style backing track because it's in E. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to play. This could be fun. This could go disastrously wrong. So I'm going to try not to play too many notes here. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to play in E minor pentatonic, but I'm going to fret E flat minor pentatonic. So we're fretting E flat, but I'm playing the notes of E. So every note I'm going to bend by a semitone. This will preclude me from playing too many notes, but what we might get is something like this. Challenging too. Let's go a little longer with that. Pre-bends all the way. Now, again, absolutely not the easiest thing to do. So you're going to hear some kind of out of tune stuff in there. As I've said to you guys before, you will hear mistakes on these streams because guitar players make mistakes. If you hear guitar players that don't make mistakes, one of two things has happened. Either it's Tom Quayle or it's somebody you should be very suspicious of. Tom's a machine though. He's not a person. He's some kind of weird space robot who's joking. I love Tom. But it just freaks me out with how accurate it is. But if you hear guitar players, if they never make mistakes, there's never any string noise, any scuffs, be suspicious. The guitar is a noisy instrument. Anyway, listen, we're not here to throw shade on people, but that's why you'll always hear mistakes in my streams, because I think it's important to recognize that everyone makes them, and we shouldn't be ashamed of that. So anyway, this pre-bending thing is a great way to practice this stuff because it forces you to be very deliberate about the notes that you're playing, but it also forces you, because you can't play loads of notes, it forces you to really analyze the way that your vibrato sounds, if that's what you're working towards, which in this case, we are. So anyway, guys, we have reached the 45-minute mark, so it's time to do the Q&A. Let's get stuck into that. We've got some really, really great questions coming. If you guys have some questions, I'm going to give you 1 minute to get them in. So we have 1 minute. Drop your questions in the comments. If you want to know something, you want to talk about this, you want to talk about something else, then we'll do it. We'll absolutely do it. I'm going to play just a little bit longer. I'm going to stick with the Led Zeppelin thing. I'm going to maybe throw some, you know what, I said I'm going to do the Top Gun ballad. I'll do the Top Gun ballad. All of these tracks are available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel for free, by the way. Links will be in the description. So here we go. We're in D, in case you're wondering. Let's go to the close-up camera. And away we go. So, ladies and gentlemen, hope you got your questions in because it is time for the Q&A. Hey, look at that, branding change and everything. So let's get stuck in. We got some great questions already. I will try my best to answer as many of these as I can. I've been getting wrong for going over the hour, so I'll try my best, but let's keep on cracking. So let's go right up to the top. We had some really, really good ones, and I am going to try and answer as many of them as I can. So let me just keep on scrolling. If you have anything you want to know about in particular, remember, just drop them in the comments. So let's see. Ah, Mark McNish says, every beginner needs the hot fix lessons. That refers to technique hot fixes. Man, you gotta check this out. This is just a collection of wisdom that it took me 25 years to put together. Don't be like me, be smarter than me. Just go and get these lessons. They're in the, links will be below. You want these, that's what I'm saying. If you're a GI Plus member, you get them for free. So anyway, let's keep on rocking. What do we have going on here? Schwarzenegger used to live in Romford, says David Yates. Hey, I thought so too. I'm pretty sure I saw him in Tesco the other day. So let's keep on rocking. What else do we have? We've got some great questions. I promise we have so many comments. I love seeing your comments. I'm just going to dig in. We're going to find some of these questions. Here we go. Live to play guitar. Any tips on not leaving the vibrato too early? Thanks. Okay, now, I'm going to approach this from two perspectives. First of all, if you find yourself at a point where you have, this is more of a philosophical thing. If you find yourself at a point where you're doing this, this is what we mean by giving up the vibrato too early, by the way, where we might go. If you feel like you're done with the vibrato on a particular note, you're probably done with that note, then you can stop. It's okay. You don't have to play all of the time. You can stop. Now, this sounds super patronizing, but guitarists need to hear this. Not because we are like too egotistical or too dumb to stop or any of that stuff, but because there's pressure on us to play lots. It's what we do. It's a guitar player, you know? I guess it's more just being told that it is all right. It's fine. It's okay. You can stop. So if you are done with a note, and you feel like you're not quite sure what to do, ask yourself, what would Keith do? What would Keith Richards do? He would stop. And then maybe have a smoke. Don't do that. But, you know, have a pose, that's for sure. Have a dance. If you drink whiskey, maybe that's your thing. Maybe you can do some of that. Another thing to do with regarding not leaving the vibrato too early is don't apply the vibrato too early. Maybe leave a little bit of breath before you apply the vibrato. If you want to have a long, long, long note, couple of things you can do. You can either dig into your long note and vibrato it forever and a day, which can sound very cool, or you can take a bit of time before you apply it. So that's something to think about. Maybe don't apply it too soon. If you feel like you've hit a really great note, you've started the vibrato, you don't want to stop, here's a cool trick you can do. Get your thumb and your another finger from your right hand, I'll show you in this camera real quick, and dampen these strings down like this. So I'm playing on the B string. I'm gonna dampen down the strings either side of the string I'm playing on and just vibrato the absolute ever-loving whatever out of this particular note and really give it some pressure with your left hand so it starts to grind against the fret and you get this. This is the pressure thing we talked about where you might get. Now that, if you're sustaining a note on vibrato, can sound really, really cool. So getting that pressure in there, it's gonna make things grind just a little bit. It will put a bit extra wear on your frets, but not anything that you should be concerned about. It'll, you know, you'll get 10 years out of them instead of 20 years, whatever. It's a price worth paying for having 10 years of great sounding vibrato, I think. So yeah, that's a couple of tips. I know, really, really, really great questions. Lift play guitar. So if you feel like you're done with vibrato, you're probably done with the note, so just stop. If you want a long note, but you don't feel like you want to put the vibrato on for ages, that's okay, just wait a while before you put it on. Or if you start doing it and you want to keep going, mute it down, commit, and just keep on going. The last thing to pay attention to is when it is time to stop, don't be afraid to use your right hand to deaden the note. So there, I'm using the palm of my right hand to deaden down that vibrato note. Another strategy is when you're done, slide off. Slide off is a cool way to do things. Just kind of let it be, let it slide off. Very, very cool question into that. So big, big old question. Let's keep on going. Let's keep going. So we have other more questions. Larry H says, violins and singers just need some frets. That is all. Could you imagine? My friend and fellow Mark Craig, I know who this is, says wrestling. Any wrestling fans in the audience, by the way, that's us. We are big nerds and we love a bit of that. Saying nothing. It's from Blazing Saddles is what that is. So anyway, let's keep on rocking. We've got some more great questions. Billy's Fat Bob, in reference to the pressing of the thumb really hard, just sprained his thumb. Bob, your thumb is too strong for this world. That's what I'm going to say. David Yates, what inspired you to take up the guitar, Nick, and how old were you when you started? I was 12 years old when I started, and I got in trouble in a lesson at school. My friend Carl, and we were in detention, and he asked me if I wanted to join his band. This was the mid-90s, and nobody was in bands. Like early to mid 90s, everything was like too unlimited. Bands didn't really exist. It was pre Oasis, so we didn't really have bands. I'd never met anybody who was in a band. And I was like, no, you're not in a band, don't be stupid. And he's like, yeah, I am. And he's like, well, what can you play? He said to me, and I said, well, I've got a keyboard. And he said, you can't play keyboard in my band. There's no keyboards in Guns N' Roses. That changed. No keyboards in Guns N' Roses, no keyboards in my band. You will have to learn the guitar. So he invited me around to his house. Gave me a go on his guitar, and the rest is history. And that's how I started playing guitar. True story. If I hadn't have told everybody to order potato ice cream in a diorama in French, I wouldn't be here today. So anyway, let's keep going. More questions. Any advice on Gary Moore style bending? Cheers. Yeah, 100%. First of all, Gary Moore, the man, right? Just what a great, great, great guitar player. One of the things that Gary did so beautifully was he managed the tension and the arc in his bends better than 99.999% of guitar players who've ever roamed the earth. I'm sure there are others. But what I'm talking about here is on these beautiful somber ballad numbers where you would get these kind of... Send the vibrato off there. That vibrato, that delay off. That's going to be a little irritating. And let's throw a backing track on for this. Let's maybe take this backing track here. We'll do the slow blues in E minor, which was the first backing track we released. We might get this sort of thing. Way more lyrical with that stuff than I could ever hope to be. But what we have is this beautiful contrast between really, really aggressive, fast, lots of pressure, really kind of digging in bends. And by digging in, we mean digging in with the left hand to create that grindy pressure. And then super smooth, loose, relaxed, gentle touch bends. Gary was very physical with his instrument. And that doesn't just mean being aggressive. That extends both ways. Being very physical with your instrument means to physically embody the music. And that can mean being very physical in being so light with your touch that your whole body becomes light. Great example of this is Steve Vai. You watch Steve Vai do his slides and all this kind of thing. He'll do this shouldery thing. That is being physical with the instrument. So I guess, pardon me, I guess some advice on the Gary Moore type bends is to physically embody the music, allow it to move you physically, not just like in sense of, oh, I'm so moved by the music, allow it to let you move your body. Just allow yourself to move, allow that movement to transition onto the guitar. It's very, very touchy-feely, woo-woo stuff, I know, but that is like, probably one of the best Best examples I can think of. Here's an interesting one. Can you demo close-up finger muscles versus forearm and fulcrum from the bottom of the neck? Yeah, let's do that. Okay, so this is as close-up as I can get, but let's try from this perspective. So if I turn the camera this way, the finger muscles, we're gonna do three examples here. So finger muscles would be if we did this. Without moving the thumb setup, forearm and upper arm muscles would be this. Fingers, forearm. Watch this unusually hairy part of my hand here. I'm not a wolf, I promise. See the difference? Didn't have to put my thumb over the top, didn't have to do any fulcruming, but that's what's going on there. Now let's do the fulcrum bend. So if I do a pull bend like this, with fingers, kind of difficult, very difficult to maintain my finger positioning, all sorts of other things. There's fingers. Here is a pull with the arm. And here's a pull with a fulcrum. This is fine. This is fine. This, probably not okay. It's just gonna lead you to more trouble than it's worth. But then, for every player, for everything we say is kind of, you know, the wrong thing to do, you can find great players who do it. So there are always exceptions. Let's keep digging, and we have more questions. We've got a few more. Let's just dig in here. We've got some really, really great comments regarding the kind of like your favorite players, all that kind of stuff. What else do we have? We're gonna do one more, question. Here we go. How much of the vibrato is dictated by the hardware slash amp slash guitar with regards to sustain length? Ooh, now that's interesting because it definitely plays a role. Part of it is volume. So if you ever listen to Stevie Ray play, the missing component in Stevie Ray's tone is just how effing loud it is. Like, if you've ever tried to get that Stevie Ray tone, first of all, we are mere mortals. It's not gonna happen, right? Unless you have a Stevie, probably not gonna happen. But the fact that he was able to sound much the same on all of his various strats, including ones with lipsticks, should tell you that that's not a huge component. It's definitely something to it. And you know, all these different tube screamers that he had and all fundamentally sounded the same. The volume is a big part of it because volume physically interacts with the guitar. It physically causes feedback on the string. And what we mean by that is feedback. The volume of the volume of the air you're displacing is causing the string to vibrate. So that's kind of where that comes from. That's part of it. But even at a fairly low volume that we're playing today, we can't play loud. Otherwise, this little mic here that I'm sure I've just deafened you all by touching, is gonna pick up what we're playing and it's gonna sound terrible. It'll be all phasey and weird. A lot of gain helps. Not having a noise gate helps. But we're playing pretty quiet. I'm gonna set up a not terribly gainy sound. So maybe I'll do something like this. I'll turn the gate off just to give myself a little bit of a break. Playing too many notes to hear my own sustain. You guys can hear that's still going. So even without a great deal of gain on, we can make a guitar sustain. Now this guitar, it's a great guitar. Right, I've played a load of gigs in this guitar. I've played this a lot. I have this theory, it's totally unscientific, that the more you play guitars, the better they get. I think you fill them up with love and they respond appropriately. Or you fill them up with rage and bile or whatever and they respond appropriately, whatever, it doesn't really matter. It's also PRS. PRS is the same forever. They are like one big sweet spot. It's crazy. Like some guitars have a sweet spot here, or maybe they have one around here. PRS, just sweet spot from start to finish. Everything is sweet. I don't know how they do it. It's crazy. Witchcraft. I gather some of the earlier guitars had troubles with that around here. That's where this big heel came in. which some people have complained about. It's clearly working. But a big part of this regarding sustain is not attacking the notes so aggressively that it rattles off the nearby frets, which can kill some sustain. So if I really lay into a note, like this, for example, you can hear how that negatively impacts the sustain. Now I'm able to claw that back by being fairly gentle with my left hand and just kind of like massaging the string back into a straight line. It's very difficult to describe. So technique definitely plays a role. I feel like the hardware is definitely something to do with it too. So we've gone over, of course we have, I always go over. Guys, I wanna know if you're gonna play along with me. So we're gonna go back to that track that we played on in the intro. I'm gonna play us out on that track. I want your videos. I want to hear you. I want to hear you play. So the thing to do is follow us on Instagram. You know what to do. Follow us on Instagram. Get your video to us either by tagging us in it, sending us a DM with either a YouTube link or the Instagram video. For those three guys that submit your videos this week, we are going to upload those. I'll take some passes at them tomorrow. We'll get it uploaded this week and we'll share it around. It's been really kind of you to submit your playing. You all played absolutely tremendously. There's some great tones, really great choices on display. It's been a blast. We're gonna do more. So the track this week, I will post in the comments after this stream, but I'm gonna play along with it now. Follow us on Instagram. We wanna hear your take. I'm gonna switch to a slightly more gained out amp. I'm gonna throw some delay on. I'm gonna play us out. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. We will be back next Monday with more stuff to help you be a better, more fulfilled and fundamentally happier guitar player. Thank you so much for joining me. It is the highlight of my week doing these streams. I really, really do love it. I will see you guys on Monday. If you haven't done so already, be sure to check out GI Plus. Technique Hot Fixes is the latest course, but more courses are coming all of the time. And I mean all of the time. We've got so much killer stuff coming for you this year. You do not want to miss out on this. You can buy the courses as a stream-only download or you can just sign up. It's cheaper. It's way cheaper. Sign up for the membership, right? It's super cheap. You get all sorts of great stuff. More on that in a bit. But for the time being, this is our jam track of the week. It's in C sharp minor. It's dead, dead easy, but it's great fun. It's going to sound thus. Let's do it. We'll be right back. was fun. Thank you so much for having me, guys. My name is Nick Jennison. I will see you next week. In the meantime, this right here, this GI Plus. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.